content, frequencies and more that people are subjected to on a daily basis, especially the young. Well, roughly when did this start? Who writes these songs on their lyrics? Which artists wittingly or all unwittingly might be involved? Let's find out. Please welcome Mark Devlin.
Cheers, Mark. Evening, folks. Thanks for turning out tonight. Sorry for the technical difficulties once again. Despite being a DJ, I'm actually a technical Luddite, totally clueless, always reliant on there being some techno boffins around to help me out. So, that's important. I've done probably about 10 of these talks now with this content, and each time it grows in length because I find myself needing to add lyrical content to it or needing to add something topical that's just happened in the music industry to help illustrate the points. So it's up to about 3 hours now, and I know we don't have 3 hours tonight, so I'm going to present an abridged version, and I'm going to be zipping through various aspects of it quite quickly, but we'll see where it takes us anyway. Little bit of introduction then, just to set the scene. I've been a DJ for the last 24 years, radio and club DJ, and I've been fortunate enough to travel all over the UK in that time and to many different countries around the world. And for many years, I didn't really give much thought to what it was I was a part of. I just played the role that was expected of a DJ in terms of taking music that you're serviced by the record companies and the promo companies and playing it in appropriate settings. And as I say, I was quite oblivious to anything else that might be going on behind the scenes for many years. But it got to 2008, and at that point in my life, I started having quite a lot of questions about what was really going on in the world and what this world and this reality is anyway. And the process started in 2008 with me reading a lot of books by various different authors and researchers. Much of it I was put onto by my dad, who's always been a free-thinking, alternative-minded sort of guy. And the process accelerated by 2010.
Control and manipulate pretty much every area of human activity. So they've had politics locked down since the year dot. They've come to infiltrate and control the educational establishments, schools, colleges, universities and such. They've come to infiltrate the scientific establishment in terms of establishing scientific norms and in terms of building a perception of what is possible and what isn't possible in the physical world or apparently physical world. They've come to infiltrate and control all the big corporations, all the telecoms and communications industries, the food and drink industries, and the military, of course. And once you've taken the time and trouble to manipulate and control all those different areas of human life, it would be very remiss of you to leave out a brilliant opportunity for mind control and social engineering and shaping people's perceptions of themselves and the world that they live in that is presented by the entertainment industry. And the three main strands of that would be the television industry, Hollywood movies, and the music industry. And the music industry is what sparked my interest in terms of the way it's used for these purposes, having been a lifelong music fan and having worked in it for so long. I bought my first record when I was 5, so I've always been into the pop music of the day. That was Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody, by the way, if anyone's wondering, which isn't too uncool. I reached the point where I came to realise that what I was a part of as a radio and club DJ was being used for questionable ends by those that don't have humanity's best interests at heart, shall we say. So there's many aspects to how the music industry is being used along these lines, and we're going to look at a fair few of those this evening. Always good to start with a quote from Plato. Plato, I feel, which just sums up the way that music is so powerful in making you feel a certain way. It can really play with the emotions and really create sensations. And of course, the manipulators know this. So one of the first things that really sparked my attention was some of the symbolism and imagery that was starting to get put into music videos. I remember days when music videos bore some kind of relation to the song and the artist in question. Often they were very overblown and pretentious, but you didn't get a lot of dark occult symbolism in them, which we've seen over the past few years. And I noticed this happening from around about 2007, 2008, big time, when it really seemed like the agenda was getting stepped up. Here's a good example from the song Die Young, lovely song by Kesha. Sentiments are all about, hey, let's all go out and get wasted and party and have sex with whoever we want, because we're all going to die young anyway, and life is just pointless and aimless, so who cares? Really nice sentiments for a teenage audience there. And in the video, there are three stills here, and we have an upside-down cross, we have a pentagram, which you might expect to be inverted, but in this instance it's not, and we have a pyramid with an all-seeing eye in it. And this is very representative of many symbols that I'm seeing cropping up time and time again in popular music videos. We have one here from the song Scream and Shout, Will.i.am and Britney Spears. And here's just one of so many examples you see now of a pyramid. We've also got some monarch butterflies going on in this as well. And if I get time to go into the section on mind control, MKUltra mind control and monarch programming, you'll see how that fits in. Here's a lovely one as well for your kids to see. This is a video by Rihanna from the single Umbrella, which came out in 2007, big number one hit. And you have this scene where, on the left there, she's apparently striking a particular pose within a pyramid. But when you look at the image closer, you see that that pose is physically, anatomically impossible to achieve. And the image has been digitally manipulated, and there are many researchers that have said that what we're seeing is a depiction of Baphomet, the satanic entity, as it's been adopted as. And we've got the horns going on there, and we've got the sort of face of Baphomet being evoked by this image. Either way, pretty dark stuff to find in a pop video, I'm sure you'd agree. And the other thing about this particular image is that it's on screen for a split second. You blink and you miss it, and it's gone. And this is designed, of course, to go straight into the subliminal mind, which absorbs so many things that the conscious mind doesn't. And that's where the real power and the effect lies. This is another split second image that you see in a song, it's claimed to be, by Lil Wayne, Love Me. I don't know what I'd call it, but it wouldn't be a song. And there's a line in it where he says, "These hoes love me like Satan, man." I'm not entirely sure why the hoes would love Satan in the first place, but apparently they do. And at the point where he says that, he kind of turns into this demonic entity, and you've got the girl there with a monarch butterfly covering one of her eyes. Again, that's a split second one. As is this, and there's no apparent reason for this to be in the video that it is. It's in a video by Robin Thicke, Give It To You. And for a split second, again, blink and you miss it, you get this horrific kind of demonic face just flashing up on the screen. It's a bit dark there, but I'm sure you can get the idea of what's going on. Another pyramid image from Rihanna, they're all over the place. You see the same sort of images cropping up time and time again with the same artists as well. This one is Kanye West's video for Power, and you've got everything going on here. And the interesting thing about this video is it's just one image for the course of the 3-minute song. And the camera starts panned in on some very close detail, and during the course of the song it pans out and you get to see more and more of the detail. Those that study
symbolism and the occult would have a field day with this, but there's all kinds of stuff going on. I would question what it's doing in an apparent pop music video. So now we get into some of the interesting hand symbols that many of the A-list artists are flashing up in their videos all the time now. This was something that I started to look at the same time as all these symbols in videos. This is a very common one, which Jay-Z has done many times over the years. And he makes this sort of triangular sign with his hands. And the cover story for it is that it's the rock sign. It's referred to as the rock sign. It's supposed to be a celebration of bling hip-hop culture, rags to riches, you know, making it big through the music game. And he will throw up the instruction in live concerts to all the fans to throw up your rock signs. And it's supposed to symbolise a diamond, as in a rock. And I was interested quite a while later to discover that this particular sign is one of the grade signs that was used by the AA occult organisation. Nothing to do with alcohol or automobiles, but one of the secret societies that Aleister Crowley was ahead of at one time. And here we have Jay-Z flashing up this same symbol. And here's the guy that he chose to name his record company after. Rockefeller, David Rockefeller there, patriarch of the Rockefeller bloodline currently. Jay-Z, when he first formed his record label, decided to call it Rockefeller, as in Rock a Fella. These days it's known as Rock Nation. But of all the people that you could use as an inspiration for your business venture, I would question your judgment if you choose this guy, given what his family represents. And so here we have a bunch of Jay-Z fans on instruction, throwing up their rock signs in a concert. And I came to understand, as part of this conscious awakening, that everything in existence is made up of sound and light energy, vibrating and resonating at different frequencies. And it's all about manipulating energy. If you understand the way reality works, and if you want to harness it and control it in line with your agenda. And clearly, those that pull the strings of the music industry understand this, and they have a vested interest in certain symbols being put out there into the sort of morphogenic field, because they have an effect on the reality that manifests as a result of that. And so it's all about the will and the intent that is placed on the symbol when it's created. So you have these fans thinking that the symbol they're throwing up is representing one thing, the celebration of, you know, bling hip-hop culture, but in actual fact, those that have manipulated them into creating this symbol have other intentions as to the effect that it's intended to have. And as I said, it doesn't always have humanity's best interests at heart. Here we have a familiar symbol, the pyramid with the all-seeing eye and the detached capstone that you see on the back of the US dollar bill. And we see that cropping up many times in videos and other symbols as well, which we'll get onto. Jay-Z and his best mate Kanye West doing the same symbol. Another one there. And here's Mrs. Jay-Z, Beyonce, although probably not for much longer, if the celebrity rags are to be believed. And this was at a Grammys event in 2013, where Beyonce was performing at the halftime show, and she spontaneously threw up this same hand signal just for a split second as the cameras were on her. And there was some speculation at the time as to what the meaning was behind this. The cover story, because there's always a cover story, was that she was paying homage to her old man's record label and kind of supporting him, but there could be something else going on here, I would suggest. And all this stuff with hand signals has become so embedded in popular culture now that the sun, that bastion of truth and integrity,
actually ran an article on it last year, and they titled it Jay-Z, Rihanna, and the Cabal Obsessed with Triangles That Now Runs the World, with allegedly in brackets. And the tone of the piece is very mocking, you know, they're kind of taking the piss out of conspiracy theorists, so-called, and kind of writing it all off as just this innocent thing. And they would suggest that the reason the artists choose to put up these hand signals and all the rest of it is just to be cool and to be fashionable. But you'd expect the Sun to kind of write off the story in that way, because that's its agenda. But I do find it interesting that the whole thing has embedded itself in popular culture to the extent that the Sun is actually running stories on it. And here we have Anton LaVey, founder of the Church of Satan in the US, throwing up the same symbol that we've seen before a few times. So that particular hand signal certainly gets around a bit. And we're back to the pyramid, another one that crops up time and time again. And this featured on the back of a jacket worn by Madonna in the movie Desperately Seeking Susan, going back to 1985 for this, long before any talk of the Illuminati or New World Order or any such concepts were being discussed, you know, on a cultural level. And who noticed this at the time or understood the significance of it? But when you see artists brazenly flaunting symbols like this, which are basically the calling cards of the organizations that own them, they're just sending out a little message there as to who their true masters are. And we'll also get into the extent to which many of these artists are truly owned and have truly sold their souls to the corporations that control them as we go on. And not speaking figuratively either, speaking literally. So here's another hand signal that we'll see a lot of, and it's Beyoncé once again. And this was, I think, the Super Bowl halftime show of last year, straight after the Grammys. And she was in the audience this time, and as the camera came round, she flashed up this symbol with her fingers. And as I said, everything comes with a cover story in this world, an innocent, plausible deniability sort of reason for it being. And this symbol is often taken popularly to mean okay. When you do this, you're just saying everything's okay, everything's cool. But I would suggest that it has other connotations. Many researchers into the dark occult will tell you that it's a depiction of a six, and the three fingers are supposed to indicate the fact that you're taking the six three times, so effectively it's 666. And if that is a symbol that you want getting put out there into the energetic field and having the effect that you desire, what better way than to create a cover story for it and to get everyone thinking that what they're actually saying is, it's okay, everything's okay. But in actual fact, it's having another effect without these people realizing it. And here we have Justin Bieber, and we'll hear from him later as well, doing the same sort of thing over the eye as well. So it's two symbols for the price of one there. And a very young Michael Jackson. One thing that I did come to discover was that the manipulation and control of prominent music artists goes way back, pretty much to the creation of the pop music industry. I was a bit green and a bit naive in the early days in terms of thinking it to be a modern phenomenon, something that's, you know, really happened with artists in the last few years. But it becomes clear as you look into it that it's been going on forever. So here's a young Michael Jackson probably having no clue what's going on, just being asked to do this signal in a photo shoot. And not just pop stars either. You see some of these symbols going on in other walks of life as well. And so you have to ask yourself what's really happening and what are they really trying to communicate here? Could it be that ultimately all these individuals, from Obama to Justin Bieber and everyone in between, is owned and controlled by the same individuals that operate from behind the shadows? So there's Bill Clinton doing it.
Sorry for the grainy photograph, but there's George Bush Sr. doing it as well. Where do you start with that guy? I haven't got time to go into him tonight. Benjamin Netanyahu, just a coincidence, nothing to worry about. The Pope, impersonating an owl. But why would he? The mass-murdering, paedophile, Satanist, war criminal, Tony Blair. And his... Yeah, I was holding back a bit there. That was the edited version. And here's a few more faces that we recognise of late as well. Can you tell what's going on yet? Can you tell what it is? Yeah, every time I put him on, it brings a gasp. I love the reaction to that one. So, yeah, here we have some old family favourites all doing the same symbol. And before we leave it, here's one more. No further comment on that one. We're not allowed to yet, are we? The time will come. And so we go to the Beatles. And there's a fair bit to say about the Beatles as well. As I say, this thing goes way back to decades past. In this very interesting promo pic for Yellow Submarine, we got Paul McCartney doing the same sort of owl thing that the Pope was. And we got John Lennon doing the old horned hand Baphomet sign. And this is interesting as well. Tony Prince, the founder of the DMC Disco Mix Club, and a prominent DJ on Radio Luxembourg for many years, at the funeral of his mate Jimmy Savile, felt the need to flash up that sign to the camera as well. And one more thing that we see time and time again with popular artists is a depiction of the devil horns. There's a particularly sinister one from Eminem, which is quite unsettling. I'm sure you'd agree. And once again, it's a symbol that we can see depicted by Anton LaVey, our old mate from the Church of Satan. There he is doing the horned hand sign there, which many researchers have suggested is another evocation of the Baphomet entity and a sort of calling card of Satanism. And there it is again. And here's a few more doing it. Hillary Clinton, no great surprise with her. And Barry again. And there's Baphomet, him or herself, itself, just reminding you what it looks like and what they're all evoking with what they're doing. Something else which has been creeping into videos and promo shots quite a bit in recent years, and which I didn't understand at first, was the highlighting or the depiction of one eye. And there are various ways of doing this. There was this style of photography that became very cool and fashionable a few years ago, where you just get half of an individual's face and the other eye is out of range. And I couldn't understand why it was a good idea to do this, but you start seeing it everywhere. Here's Rihanna and Lady Gaga, and there are various ways of just drawing attention to the one eye. Sometimes it's circling it, sometimes it's covering it, sometimes there's a hat over it or hair over it. And it's all about symbolizing the all-seeing eye, the one eye that you see in the capstone of that pyramid on the dollar bill. There are also connotations there with the pineal gland, you know, the so-called third eye, and the portal to higher consciousness. And it's tied into symbolism in Freemasonry as well. And it's another big Illuminati calling card. And here's a composite that somebody put together of just all the artists that you can see doing this thing with their eye. And I know you can't see the detail, but trust me, everyone is in there. And it's pretty much all the A-list artists of the day. And you come to realize that it's no longer possible to be a successful artist in the mainstream music industry without selling your soul, signing up to the program, and stepping up to do some work for those that have placed you there. Fame and fortune comes with a heavy price these days, and all these artists are nothing more than manipulated stooges and puppets, sadly.
And there are no exceptions. There are no exceptions when we're talking about popular artists. They're all in there. And the reason I've put this Duran Duran sleeve in there is just to remind me to talk a bit about the video to this song. Because, as I said, the thing goes way back. And this record came out in 1983, so we're going back a good 30-odd years. And somebody put me onto the video recently. And you can get it on YouTube if you want to research this for yourself. But there's some very interesting symbolism in the video. And in it, you've got the group out in a desert landscape, which looks like it could be Nevada, somewhere like that. And you've got these sort of lizard, reptilian-type creatures crawling over sand dunes and stuff, which is quite telling. And then you've got this elevator, which appears with a child in it. And Simon Le Bon, the lead singer, gets into this elevator. And it goes down deep into this underground base that is very reminiscent of what we hear about Area 51, secret military base in Nevada. And then down in this underground base, you've got these kind of hybrid creatures that are half sort of lizard and half human in cages. And you've got children running around. And you know, fire everywhere, and very interesting imagery for a pop video of 30 years ago, given that many of those images are on the minds of researchers in these times, given what we now understand about so much of what happens in the world. So that's certainly a video that's worth taking a look at, and it raises all kinds of questions as to who knew what and who wanted to encode these images into that particular video to be absorbed into the public consciousness. So I said there was plenty more on the Beatles, and there is. I could equally have gone in on the Rolling Stones. There's so much to get into with regard to dark occult aspects of the Rolling Stones in terms of their music, in terms of their imagery, and in terms of stuff that went on behind the scenes. When you get into their association with the filmmaker and dark occultist Kenneth Anger. There's a lot to say there. Also about the suspicious circumstances surrounding the death of Brian Jones. And there are many researchers that have gone into this. I don't go into the Rolling Stones in this presentation purely because I've not researched it that fully and there's only so much time. So there's a lot to say about the Beatles instead, but they are by no means isolated. You know, there's a lot of other groups from that era that, it turns out, were implicated in this whole agenda in quite a deep way. So we have this promo shot from 1960-something where half of the Beatles' faces are shaded, so you just get to see the one eye, which is very reminiscent of what we've seen in these more modern pictures. And this one is a deeply unsettling and very controversial record sleeve at the time, which came out in early 1966 for the album Yesterday and Today. And in it, you have the Beatles dressed in butcher's smocks, and they're covered in raw meat and mutilated baby dolls with heads ripped off and arms ripped off and stuff. You know, it's a pretty horrific sleeve, and understandably, there was a public outcry about it, and it had to get withdrawn and replaced by another sleeve. But you've got to wonder what was trying to be communicated by putting this sleeve out in early 1966. And some researchers have suggested that the Beatles were trying to communicate some of the horrific things that go on in satanic rituals held by the elites that are running the show. We hear a lot about that in these times. And, you know, infanticide is sadly a very horrific part of that. So, was this an attempt at subliminally communicating this aspect of what goes on? So this is another promo picture for Yellow Submarine, and it's the same two hand signals that we saw, McCartney doing the sort of 666 OK sign, and Lennon doing the horned hand thing. And the cover story for that sign, which a lot of people will tell you in the mainstream, is it just means I love you. You see people doing this and it means I love you. It's supposed to be the I, the L, and the U. But again, If you want people to be putting the symbol out there and having the effect that is desired, what better way than to convince them that it's something completely trivial and innocent? So here's McCartney highlighting the one eye again, and there's Paul McCartney with Jimmy Savile, interestingly, who certainly got about. Savile toured with the Beatles in their early days. And so we get into a very early conspiracy theory in the music industry, which a lot of people have heard whisperings of, I'm sure. And it's the theory that the original Paul McCartney died in 1966 and was replaced by an imposter. And I know that when you hear that suggestion for the first time, it sounds completely ridiculous and it sounds preposterous, and you think, how could this possibly be? But when you put it into the context of some of the other stuff that we know is happening in the music industry, particularly with regard to trauma-based mind control artists, MKUltra and such, which we'll get onto if we get time, and even the suggestion that the industry actually sacrifices its own artists from time to time, with Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston, Tupac, Biggie Smalls, John Lennon, Bob Marley being a few examples of that, suddenly the suggestion doesn't sound quite as absurd as it might have done otherwise. Then you can start getting into some of the fact-based evidence, because a lot of people, understandably, aren't prepared to accept any kind of suggestion unless there's evidence to back it up. And when it comes to the idea that these two fellas aren't the same guy, and that the McCartney we know today is not the original Paul McCartney, there is actually a fair amount of reasonably plausible evidence to suggest this might be the case. And there's a researcher by the name of Tina Foster that's gone into this big time in the US, and she runs a website called Plastic Macca on Blogspot. And I interviewed her quite recently, and she breaks down a lot of the forensic evidence that forensic experts have looked at with regard to the two Paul McCartneys, so to speak. And there's all kinds of anomalies with the face shape, the shape of the jawline and the chin, the shape of the nose, the eyebrows, pretty much every feature of the face. And I think it's worth considering just the possibility that the person we understand to be Paul McCartney today may not be the original guy. And there are two kind of theories as to what may have happened there. One, which does seem to me to be fairly implausible, is the fact that the original McCartney, sometime in 1966, it's put at August by many researchers, had a blazing row at a recording studio with the other Beatles and jumped into his sports car and sped off and was inadvertently involved in an accident somewhere on the M1, so the story goes, and he was near decapitated. And those that were controlling the Beatles at the time panicked at this and realised that the money-spinning machine that was this group that had worked so well for them for so long would be over if the public ever discovered that Paul had died. So they concocted this facade where they brought in somebody to play the part of McCartney, and they passed him off as the original guy, and nobody was any the wiser. Now, this version does seem ridiculous to me, because it would involve there just happening to be somebody on hand that was prepared to spend the rest of their life impersonating Paul McCartney, that looked enough like him to be able to carry the thing off and had enough musical talent to be able to, you know, keep that deception going. So the other version of the story is the more sinister one, which is that the original McCartney was deliberately taken out, and they'd spent some time preparing this person to come in and take his place. And there are various reasons given as to why he was taken out. Apparently, the original McCartney was quite conscientious, and he was voicing his objection to the Vietnam War, which didn't suit the controllers at the time. He was starting to ask questions about the Kennedy assassination in the very early days, whether Oswald could have, you know, acted alone. And there were all kinds of other reasons. And he was very anti-drugs, the drugs agenda.
that they were trying to bring in the latter part of the 60s with LSD and such. They had their plans already laid out, and he wasn't playing ball with that. And so the suggestion goes that they decided to take him out. So, you know, I remain on the fence about it. I can't say one way or the other whether there's any validity to this, but I do consider the possibility that there might be. And for anyone who's had their interest sparked by that, I would encourage you to look at some of the evidence that's available with an open mind and weigh it all up, because some very strange and very bizarre things do go on in this world, which many years ago we might have dismissed out of hand as impossible. But the more you discover about how this world is nothing like we're told it is, the more possibility opens up to you. And some interesting things about the latter-day McCartney. He does take any opportunity to throw up the horned hand sign at his concerts these days. So we do see a lot of that. And there's a lot of hobnobbing with the Queen and, you know, the establishment. He's also a sir. And we know what most sirs get up to now, don't we? Be suspicious of any sirs, I would suggest. And just a lot of synchronicity. Really interesting sync stuff when it comes to the Beatles and the movie Rosemary's Baby. And Rosemary's Baby was directed by Roman Polanski, later exposed as a paedophile, but it's a quite incredible film. And I would suggest that its narrative has a lot more fact in it than might at first be evident. It depicts this young couple that move into an apartment building in New York, which just happens to be the Dakota Building, outside which John Lennon was shot, murdered in 1980. The film was shot in the same building. And the guy, the young guy, is a wannabe up-and-coming actor that wants to make it big. And he falls in with this group of Satanists. And it's made up of very innocent-seeming everyday people on the surface, their elderly neighbours and a doctor and all kinds of other people that you would never expect to be involved in something like Satanism. But he basically makes a pact with them in that they will give him fame and fortune and success as an actor if he does something for them, which in this case is giving up his young wife, played by Mia Farrow, to be impregnated by this demonic entity and give birth to its child. The elements of that story that I would suggest to be factually based are the idea that performers, whether it's musicians or actors or any other type of entertainment industry performers, are elevated to levels of fame and fortune and great success in exchange for making a sacrifice of some sort to the system. And often the price is a heavy one to pay. So I think that's what was encoded into Rosemary's Baby, but most people watching it would take it to be a highly imaginative work of fiction. But when you get into some of the synchronicity with the Beatles, it's quite fascinating the way these things pan out. Because you've got Mia Farrow's sister, whose name was Prudence, and the Beatles wrote the song Dear Prudence for her. And then you've got the fact that Lennon was murdered outside the Dakota Building, which is where Rosemary's Baby was set. And then you've got the Sharon Tate murders, you know, the Manson family murders involving Roman Polanski's wife at the time, Sharon Tate, who along with others were savagely murdered by members of the Manson family. And you know, there's links there too, because at the time, the Beatles' song Helter Skelter was said to have been a trigger for these crazed murderers to go on their rampage. It was supposed to be a kind of mind-controlled trigger. So there's all these links between the Beatles and Polanski and Rosemary's Baby. And the universe has a habit of doing that, just making all these things against all the odds just fit together in a synchronistic way, which is very fascinating. And we're back to some more of the grade signs that you see as part of the AA occult organisation of Aleister Crowley. On the sleeve of the Beatles' Help, you see them striking these strange poses, which just happen to correspond with many of the grade signs that you see in the AA.
Aleister Crowley, the famous occultist and known as the Beast and the wickedest man alive and all these sort of self-styled tags that he revelled in during the years that he was around, crops up a lot in popular music culture, far more than you might think. You might wonder why there would be any connection between Aleister Crowley and popular music artists of the day. But many musicians have said that they have been fascinated by his work, and he crops up on the sleeve of Sgt. Pepper by the Beatles. Sorry that picture's so small, but you can see it's highlighted there in the top left-hand corner in amongst all these characters that the Beatles referred to as our heroes and our inspirations. You get Aleister Crowley, the occultist of OTO fame and Thelema and all these other organisations that he was a part of. And there he is again in full ritual mode. And you may have heard this one as well. Many researchers suggest that George W. Bush is the grandson of Aleister Crowley, that in actual fact Barbara Bush, George Sr.'s wife, was the illegitimate daughter of Aleister Crowley. There's quite a bit of evidence to suggest that this may be the case, and there's more than a passing family resemblance, I would suggest as well, between Barbara Bush and Crowley. So there's an interesting one to ponder on there. And here's Crowley's famous quote, which was the sort of hallmark of the belief system that he put out there, his particular brand of Satanism. Do what thou wilt should be the whole of the law, which is basically taken to mean, one of the central tenets of Satanism is live your life exactly the way you choose to live it without any thought of any consequence that this might have for anyone else. Basically, it's a very selfish, self-centered, egoic worldview that is espoused by these belief systems, and it's summed up in that quote. And interestingly, we see that same quote, do what thou wilt, cropping up on a favourite sweatshirt of Jay-Z, bringing it right back up to present day. So Jay-Z would appear to be another artist that has quite a fascination for the works of Crowley, as did Jimmy Page of Led Zeppelin, still does. This is Crowley's house on the shores of Loch Ness in Scotland, Bolaskin House. And Crowley lived there for a number of years, and he performed many seances and dark occult rituals there. And when the opportunity came up to buy the house, Jimmy Page of Led Zeppelin jumped at the chance. And he himself lived there for many years, and as an adherent to Crowley's sort of belief systems and a big fan of what he stood for, he became a part of what that house represented. And one of the organisations that Crowley is associated with is the Ordo Templo Orientis, OTO. And there are many of today's celebrities that, for whatever reason, have become a part of that particular organisation. This is Peaches Geldof, who just happened to die in very suspicious circumstances earlier this year. Turns out that she was a big participant in the OTO organization. There's an upside down cross, one of the many sort of tattoos and emblems. She's also got one there with the letters OTO in a heart on her arm. And lots of things to say about what may or may not have happened there. And many of the questions could probably be answered by Bob Geldof, I would suggest. And it's an interesting thing when you get into the ancestry and the genealogy of Bob Geldof. You find out that he's actually of Jewish descent on his grandmother's side, I believe. He's not a full-blooded Irishman, as many people have believed. And again, there's lots of things to say about Geldof, which we don't have time to go into within this presentation, but there's lots more to know there, particularly about the true motivations behind Band Aid and Live Aid and such. So, we're going back again now to the late 60s counterculture, anti-establishment, hippie kind of era,
which is generally taken to have grown up out of San Francisco, particularly the Haight-Ashbury area of San Francisco. But I interviewed a researcher recently by the name of Dave McGowan, who is LA-based, and he's done a lot of work into this community within Los Angeles known as Laurel Canyon. And this was a place where, in the mid-60s, an unfeasible amount of the artists that were key to that whole kind of hippie counterculture era just happened to all come and congregate in this area called Laurel Canyon. You had The Doors, you had the Mamas and the Papas, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, Buffalo Springfield, Joan Baez, Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention, and so many others. And McGowan and others have done some digging into the family backgrounds of many of these prominent artists. And it turns out that almost without exception, all of the prominent artists from that Laurel Canyon era that helped shape that whole hippie movement came from families that were connected to the government, military, or intelligence services in the US in some way. And this raises the question of how grassroots and organic and natural that whole hippie movement might have been that encouraged young people to, you know, trip out and take acid and not worry about things and not get involved in the anti-war demonstrations with Vietnam and such. And one of the best examples of these family backgrounds is this guy, Admiral George Stephen Morrison, who just happens to be the father of Jim Morrison of The Doors. And this guy was the US naval commander who was on deck at the time of the Gulf of Tonkin incident, or non-incident, which springboarded America into the Vietnam War. And he turns out to be the father of Jim Morrison. So you've got all these artists apparently putting out this message that, you know, we're against war and it's all about just dropping out and, you know, all these kind of free love ideals and stuff that were being pushed by those artists. And in the meantime, you've got the fathers and the families that are deeply involved in the military and intelligence services. So the suggestion is that Laurel Canyon was actually a kind of breeding ground in controlled circumstances for a lot of these artists to be putting out messages which, although on the surface appeared to be opposing the establishment, were in fact all manipulated and all controlled, and were all putting ideas into the minds of young people that absolutely suited the control system of the day. Lots more to go, but I think it's time to take a little break of 10 minutes or so. So see you again soon.
Thank you. I was just saying to Rob that I've got so much content still to go through that I could actually make an all day of this, you know, David Icke style, 10 hours straight. It's clear that there's some of the information that I'm not going to have time to get into tonight. So maybe we could do a part two. I think I'm going to have to drop the section on mind control, MKUltra and modern programming. Well, okay, we can touch on it briefly, but there's so much to get into there that to do it its full justice and put it into context is going to take some more time. So maybe we could do that on another occasion. But what I'm getting into right now is another aspect of what the music industry and the entertainment industry in general is used for. And it's the concept of predictive programming. It's planting ideas and suggestions subliminally into the minds of the general public without them understanding what's going on and preparing them for something which is going to happen. And there seems to be another facet to this, to me. The elites, the controllers, the powers that be, call them what you will, whenever they commit one of their outrages or incursions, whatever, they seem to feel the need to get public consent and public approval for what they're doing. And they seem to be observing in their own sick, twisted, perverted way, the tenets of natural law, basically the moral code that is written into the fabric of the universe, the morality of the universe. Their way of observing natural law seems to be to give us the opportunity to object to something that they plan to do by announcing, albeit in a very covert, very twisted sort of way, what they plan to do. When we don't voice any kind of objection to that, and in most cases, how could we, because they make the announcement so obscure that only a few that really study symbolism and such would understand what's going on. It's not possible for us to reject these ideas and not give our consent to it. And so they take our lack of objection as our tacit approval of what they're going to do. And one of the ways in which they announce it to be absorbed again by the subconscious mind is via this concept of predictive programming. And we've seen many examples of this in Hollywood movies in recent years. A good example here, you can't see it too well there, but on this map in the Batman movie, The Dark Knight Rises, is written the name Sandy Hook. And the original name on the map was South Hinxie, but it was changed for some reason to Sandy Hook, and this movie came out just a short while before the Sandy Hook school shooting, or not, as the case may be, in Newtown, Connecticut. When it comes to 9/11, where do you start? There's YouTube videos online that go on for minutes with clips from movies that preceded 2001, which depict certain aspects of what was to come to pass on that day. This is from Independence Day, and you get a split second image on the screen of this countdown on a clock, and it's 9/11/01. So even down to the year that 9/11 happened, this was embedded into the public consciousness so that when the events of 9/11 unfolded for real, the public already had a subconscious acceptance of what was going on without realizing it. And here's another example from the Matrix movie, the original Matrix, which came out in 1999. And on Neo's passport there, the expiry date is given as the 11th of September, 01. And here's a record sleeve by the group Supertramp. And this goes back to 1980. And it's very interesting because you've got a view from outside of an aeroplane window. And you've got the Manhattan skyline there, complete with the Twin Towers. And you've got the name Supertramp at the top of the sleeve there. But somebody worked out, I've no idea how, but they worked out that if you flip the image into reverse, a very interesting thing happens. Above the Twin Towers, the elements of the Supertramp name resemble very closely a 9 and an 11. And given that this is a view from an aeroplane window coming in over Manhattan, that raises some very interesting questions about why that sleeve turned out the way it did. Here's another one. This is from a very little known group. We've heard nothing from them since, can't think why, called The Coup. And this one appeared in June 2001. So just a few weeks before the events of September 2001. And as you can see, it depicts the Twin Towers crumbling to dust there while the band are in the front. And I actually think this would be a more accurate depiction of what really went on there. I don't know if you can see that, but it's Boy Bush when inbreeding goes wrong, and Father Bush there in front of the Twin Towers. And this sleeve was understandably very quickly withdrawn when 9/11 went down. But again, you've got to ask yourself, who knew what and what was going on there? Here's a Michael Jackson sleeve, Blood on the Dance Floor. This dates back to 1997, and you see him dancing on a Masonic checkerboard there with the sort of duality of black and white with all the symbolism that entails. And in the background, a city that looks very similar to Manhattan crumbling to dust. And here's another one, just a coincidence. There's lots of those. Jay-Z, our old mate, his album, The Blueprint, just happened to be released, you might see from the top of this Amazon page there, on September 11th, 2001, of all the dates. So that's how predictive programming works. And this, I think, was another aspect of it as well. I noticed that towards the end of the 90s, you started to see in a lot of Hollywood movies a black president being depicted in movies. Morgan Freeman played him in one movie. There were several others where the president was portrayed as being black, and this was a few years before Obama was, of course, selected and ushered into place. And I think that was an example of the public being subconsciously prepared for what was to come so that they would accept it more readily when it did. And predictive programming goes on in music videos as well. Why wouldn't it? Wasted opportunity if you didn't, really. Here's Lil Wayne, the rapper, it says here. I'd call him something else. And this is a video for My Home Is Still. And he's in a movie theater, and he's surrounded by 12 skeletons. Trust me, there's 12 there in the picture. And this video came out just a few days before 12 people, we're told, just happened to get shot and killed in a movie theater in Aurora, Colorado. But again, I'm sure it's just one massive coincidence. And the movie that was being screened at the time was the Batman movie, The Dark Knight Rises. Elsewhere in the Lil Wayne video, we have some interesting sort of bat-type imagery going on. There's Batman himself, there's a girl with a sort of bat mask on. There's a scene in the video where Lil Wayne and his mate are seen hanging from the ceiling in the same fashion that bats do. So there's a lot of correlation going on there. And I thought it'd be nice to give you a lyric from that song, because I wanted to bring some examples of the sort of content that's going into so-called hip-hop records these days. You know, I've been a DJ for many years, and I've been into hip-hop culture, and I remember better days. I remember when hip-hop made sense, and the lyrics had something to say, made some kind of statement, which was the original sort of basis of hip-hop culture in the first place. Or even if they were about nothing in particular, they were just about partying and having a good time, you know, they weren't dealing with the same kind of content as this. I don't really need to go through it because it's kind of self-evident, but one interesting aspect of the lyrics here was, I've got to put that patch over my third eye. And then the chorus goes, don't make my goons go stupid, go stupid, go stupid, which of course is exactly what these type of records are intended to do with the kids that are lapping them up. And unfortunately, you've got a whole generation of young people right now who weren't around to remember better days, better times, when it all made sense. And they're being constantly fed the idea that Lil Wayne and Nicki Minaj and Rick Ross and Drake and 2 Chainz and all these other jokers are, you know, where it's at. This is hip-hop. These are the people you should look up to. These are your role models. And this is the sort of content that is going into records, which are played on the radio as well. It's incredible. You hear these tunes on stations like Radio 1, One Extra, Capital Extra and such on certain shows. And they will take a swear word, fuck for instance, and to make it palatable for the radio, they just omit one syllable, and it's like the middle syllable, so it's the bit. So they'll say, I've k. And because they've got rid of a little bit in the middle, it's no longer the word fuck, and so it's considered acceptable to be played on the radio. It's amazing. You know, they do it with bitch as well. Bitch will become bitch. Or, you know, there'll be a little bit missing, and that somehow makes it okay. And it really is amazing that this stuff is what kids are listening to now, but at the risk of sounding like a fire and brimstone preacher or some kind of purist, that's what's happening. Yes, well, we'll get into this very quickly. It's the concept of backmasking, subliminal messages placed in audio in records. There was a high-profile court case involving the group Judas Priest in the early 80s, which brought the whole idea into the public consciousness. Interestingly, Aleister Crowley made a comment, let him train himself to think backwards. And there's also this concept of when you reverse recordings of people's speech in certain circumstances. You can hear hidden messages being relayed backwards that reflect what was subconsciously on the mind of the speaker at the time that they were saying something. So they'll say something forwards, which might be very innocent and very everyday. And when you play the recording in reverse, it reveals all kinds of things about what was really on their mind, and you can hear certain words and phrases clearly coming through. And there have been elements of this in recorded music as well. One of the most famous examples is Led Zeppelin's Stairway to Heaven, and there's a portion of that song where if you play it backwards, it sounds very much as if they're saying, "Here's to my sweet Satan," and there's many other lyrics as well. And on Led Zeppelin's Wikipedia page, they actually address this, and they give you a little snippet of the audio, the section of the song in question played forwards, and they give you a little snippet of the audio of that same section played backwards, so that you can listen to them and compare them for yourself. So that's something that people might want to do. The last time I checked, it was still on their Wikipedia page, which is quite an incredible thing. But again, it just shows how much the idea of backmasking and backwards messages has entered the public consciousness. The Beatles did this with a lot of their records, all those that manipulated the Beatles, at least. Many examples of that. I'm going to have to skip through this bit. There's stuff involving the Madonna song, Justify My Love, and I usually tell an entertaining anecdote about it, but I haven't got time for that today. But I put this one in here just to remind me to talk about this video that you can find on YouTube. It's Obama in one of his early speeches in his Yes We Can campaign. And he's up on stage and he's making all these statements, and at the end of it he's saying, "Yes, we can." And somebody's reversed the audio to the video so that every time he says, "Yes, we can," it sounds very much as if you're hearing, "Thank you, Satan." And I guess...
Bob the Builder says that.
Indeed. Well, it's BBC, so, you know. There is an element here of, I guess, you hear what you want to hear. Skeptics will say that if you want to hear something enough, you will make yourself hear it. As with all things, it's down to each individual to make up their own mind, you know, what they think of it. But it's stuff you can do for yourself. You can get this video if you go into Google or YouTube and just put in Obama, "Yes we can, thank you Satan." You'll be able to get the video, listen to it for yourself. As far as I'm concerned, this stuff does go on, and there's lots of very unsettling stuff that we don't understand about what's being done to us in terms of mind control and subliminal programming. And I would suggest that, you know, that this stuff is real. Nice quote from Aristotle to make myself sound cultured, but it does fit. We're getting into sound frequencies now, and just this concept of everything in existence being made up of sound and light energy vibrating at different frequencies. And there's a lot of work that's been done by the Japanese scientist and researcher, Dr. Masaru Emoto, which I'm sure a lot of people will be familiar with. He's done a lot of work with water crystals and exposing water crystals to words. And these can be words in written form as well as in sound form, because the intention and the will behind the word is the same whether it's expressed in written form or in spoken form. The words themselves and the elements that they're made up of, the letters of the alphabet, carry a certain resonance and a certain energy, and they have meaning. And he worked out that water has consciousness, and that the consciousness of water can absorb the energy and the intent behind certain words when it's exposed to it. And he freezes water crystals very quickly after they've been exposed to these words, and then studies the patterns that they make. And there are some examples here of these sort of beautiful harmonic patterns that are created by certain words and certain sounds. Mozart's symphony, Imagine, by John Lennon. The word love, and then peace, thank you. And there's a couple of examples of what water crystals look like when they're exposed to words that have very negative, malevolent intent and phrases, such as, "I will kill you." It's horrible, it's discordant, it's all over the place, it's anything but harmonious. And it gives some indication as to the power that sound has to make us feel a certain way. And this ties into frequencies at which recordings are made. And I discovered that for many years, many decades in fact, the standard tuning frequency for musical instruments and the standard frequency to which most studio recordings are made has been A equals 440 hertz. And this was introduced in the end in the 1940s, and it came out of Nazi Germany. It was a creation of the propaganda minister Goebbels, who worked to get this established as the standard tuning pitch. Prior to 440, it was always 432. And I'm not a music producer myself, but I've got many music producer friends who tell me that 432 is a very natural, very harmonic frequency that completely syncs with the workings of the human body and the workings of the human mind, and it syncs with the whole energy of the universe, and it's very much a pleasing frequency to which music can be recorded. But for some reason, the powers that control the music industry didn't want 432, the natural harmonic frequency. They worked to get 440 established instead. And again, researchers and scientists and musicologists will tell you that 440 is a discordant, dissonant frequency that interrupts the natural flow of the human body and brain waves and puts you in a kind of agitated state without you realizing what's happening, but it's messing with your emotions and your thoughts. And that's the frequency to which most music that we listen to today is recorded. And when I first heard about 432 being the natural frequency of the universe, I remembered that in my early days of reading, I'd come across the figures 432 somewhere else. And I remembered that in Graham Hancock's Fingerprints of the Gods book, which was a real life changer for me, that book just blew me away. He reveals that the Great Pyramid of Giza is a scale model of the northern hemisphere of the Earth, on a scale of 1 to 43,200. So we have the 4, the 3, and the 2 being expressed in the fact that the Great Pyramid, it incorporates the transcendental value of pi, so it can represent a sphere or half a sphere in its dimensions. And if you were to place the Great Pyramid over the northern hemisphere of the Earth on that scale, you would find the apex of the pyramid sitting on the North Pole and the base of the pyramid going around the equator. So that was a bit of a mind blower. Then you get into the phenomenon of precession of the equinoxes, the movement of the planets and the sun and the Earth. It's another one that was in the Hancock book. And it turns out that one astrological age in a precessional cycle is 2,160 years, two ages therefore being 4,320. So what we're starting to see is the figures of 432 and the derivatives and multiples of it. So half of 432 being 216, half of that again is 108, double it is 864. It's part of a cosmic code, a cosmic pattern that we see being expressed in the very workings of the universe in so many ways. So we get to the polar diameter of Saturn, 108,000 kilometers, 108 being a quarter of the 432. Saturn's orbital period, 10,800 days. The zeros are irrelevant when you get into the numerology of this. It's the main figures that are the important ones, the 108, the 216, etc. The Great Pyramid in Mexico, overall base of 864 standard units, twice 432. Diameter of the Sun being 864,000 miles, so there's 432 twice expressed as 864. And it goes on, the Moon has a diameter of 2,160 miles. It turns out that 6 times 6 by 6 comes to 216. And there are 864,000 seconds in a day. 432,000 for day, 432,000 for night. And another one which blew my mind, I was listening to a Red Ice radio interview with this guy, Marty Leeds, American researcher. And he's devised this method of gematria, assigning numerical values to letters. And the way his version works is to start at 1, being A, and to count up to 7 with G, and then to start counting back down from 7 to 1. So he splits the alphabet in half, 13 on each side, and you go up to 7 and back down to 1 on each side. So each letter, therefore, has a numerical value. And he pointed out in this interview that if you take the word Jesus as an example, what you get is, for those letters, 4 by 5 by 6 by 6 by 6. And if you do the multiplication, it comes to 43,200. It's fours and threes and twos and derivatives of it everywhere in the universe. And it leaves me in no doubt that 432 is the harmonic frequency. And that is the frequency at which we should be listening to our music, and not 440. This is the stuff that I'm sadly going to have to skip. It's all the stuff on mind control. But very briefly, as I'm sure many people will be aware, unfortunately, rather inconveniently, there is this thing called trauma-based mind control. And a very well-known element of it goes by the name of MKUltra. And there are divisions of that known as Monarch programming and Beta programming. And it's all stuff that, again, came out of Nazi Germany at the end of World War II. As part of Operation Paperclip, there were a lot of Nazi scientists that had been working on these mind control experiments in the concentration camps that were covertly brought over to the United States to continue the work for the CIA. And trauma-based mind control is horrific. It's, you know, one of the worst things that can be done to a human, I would suggest. It involves exposing them to horrific, traumatic experiences. And the trauma is so difficult for the human mind to deal with that it causes it to shatter into different compartments, or dissociate, as it's known. And it's possible then for each of these compartments of the mind, each of these shattered segments, to be programmed with a different personality. And you end up with multiple personality disorder. You end up with someone who has a front alter, as it's known. These different compartments of the mind are known as alters. You have a front alter, which is the person that relates to other people on an everyday basis. You know, that is who that person is taken to be. But beneath that, you have all these different programmed personalities which can be brought to the fore to replace the front alter with the correct trigger. And we see this depicted in movies. You know, I'm sure we've all seen sort of spy movies where you have sleeper assassins, and they're activated by hearing a certain word, or seeing a certain color, or seeing a certain pattern. It's said that Sirhan Sirhan, the guy that shot Robert Kennedy, had his mind control alter triggered by seeing a girl in a polka dot dress, a very distinctive polka dot dress design. And to this day, Sirhan Sirhan says that he can't remember anything about the day on which he assassinated Robert Kennedy. And there was, interestingly, a television show on Channel 4 a few years ago with Derren Brown. And Derren Brown was going into this whole concept of mind control. And this is amazing stuff to see on Channel 4, because it's not something that you would imagine the establishment would want the public thinking about. But, you know, Derren Brown referenced the case of Sirhan Sirhan. And the fact that he remembers nothing about what happened. And he also did an experiment where he tried to mind control a member of the public into believing that they had a mission to assassinate Stephen Fry, I think it was. Sadly, they failed, although there were blanks in the gun, but, you know. He did demonstrate the fact that this is very real and it can be done. So, as well as assassins that serve the purpose of the agenda when they want to take somebody out and blame it on the classic lone nutter. How many lone nutters do we see running rampage these days? Mind control has also been used in the entertainment industry big time, and still is. It's used in Hollywood And there have been quite a few whistleblowers and insiders from the Hollywood movie industry that have come forward to talk about the fact that this goes on. One of them is Roseanne Barr, who has made a lot of videos that you can get on YouTube exposing mind control in Hollywood, which is a very brave thing to do. But you find that many of your favorite actors exhibit all the evidence for being, you know, under the influence of mind control. You get it in the music industry as well, and there are many artists in the current glut which leave me in no doubt of the fact that they've been mind controlled and they've undergone MKUltra and this division of it known as monic programming. One of the best examples you can get is Nicki Minaj, and they even flaunt these multiple personalities now. They just put them right out there in the public and they don't even try and hide it. So many of these artists openly have these alter egos. And Nicki Minaj is known as Barbie, Barbie doll. And her female fans that just blindly, mindlessly follow everything that she does are known as Barbs. You know, these young girls that are just brainwashed and manipulated into following whichever puppet they stick in front of you this week. They're known as Barbs. And when you get into some of the imagery that's associated with mind control, you find that depictions of dolls, mannequins and dolls, crop up time and time again. And this Barbie doll imagery is something that is indicative of mind control. You also get a lot of images of teddy bears or dolls, child's dolls, with mutilated limbs, with arms and legs pulled off and such. And it's all symbolizing the loss of innocence, the loss of childhood, the fact that the mind has been shattered and won't be recovered. You know, it's deeply sinister stuff. So when you got Nicki Minaj actually calling herself Barbs, and if you've ever heard an interview with Nicki Minaj, best avoided, I grant you, but if you ever have, she slips into these different personalities during the interview. And everyone thinks it's great and it's so much fun. She's got this British voice, and she's not the only artist that does it. She's got this alter ego of the British girl. So she'll be getting interviewed on the radio. She will suddenly switch into using this British accent. Britney Spears does this as well. She's got this British girl thing. And if you listen to the record Scream and Shout with will.i.am, she spends the whole record doing the hook in this sort of fake British accent. And with that particular song, they are absolutely putting it in your face and absolutely flaunting what's going on. The song is called Scream and Shout, and it's all about, you know, the victim of mind control just trying to deal with this trauma and with these horrific things that have been done to them and wanting to scream and shout and let it all out. And they've made a pop song out of it, with Britney Spears speaking in a British accent, which is indicative of a fractured multiple personality. Deeply sick. And then with Nicki Minaj, she's got this alter ego known as Roman Zelensky, obviously a play on Roman Polanski. And she had this song called Roman Holiday. And there's some very telling lyrics in it. Take your medication, Roman. Take a short vacation, Roman. Some alterations on your clothes and brain. So they do like to flaunt this stuff, hide it in plain sight, in the knowledge that most people absorbing it and listening to these records and thinking Nicki Minaj is great and it's really fun when she starts doing this British accent will have no idea what is really going on. And the reason they control these artists is because they are obsessed with control and they like to be able to predict the outcome of everything. And they also like artists that toe the line and fall in line with the agenda and put out there the sort of lyrical content or whatever kind of sounds they decide they want people listening to. What they don't want is maverick artists expressing themselves creatively and instinctively. That's their worst nightmare. That's why we don't have any anymore. That's why all the artists are part of the corporate agenda and are all dancing to the same tune. So here's another one from Roman Holiday. My flow's the sickest and I'm a lunatic. And ain't that the truth? So Britney Spears, another
prime example of mind control. She's another one that does the British voice. Mariah Carey, same thing, slips into a British accent in interviews. Why would this be? Why would these artists do this? It makes you wonder whether the British girl thing is one of these standard sort of programmable personalities that they put into these artists. Another symbol that tends to give away the presence of trauma-based mind control, believe it or not, is Mickey Mouse imagery coming straight out of the Disney camp. Disney is a deeply satanic and deeply malevolent organization. There's much research that can be done on that, and there's much evidence to point to this. But we had these high-profile artists that all came out of the Mickey Mouse Club as part of the Disney Corporation a few years ago. Here we've got Britney Spears, Christina Aguilera, and Justin Timberlake in that picture. And they, of course, all went on to be big pop stars, highly influential on young people, and all putting out the same kind of music and the same kind of messages in that music. And then, of course, we had the famous incident with Britney Spears shaving all her hair and going a bit mad and attacking cars with umbrellas, which is actually a classic sign of the programming breaking down and wearing off and needing to be topped up. So after this incident, Britney went out of public circulation for a few months and then came back reprogrammed and ready to go all over again. Here's some more examples of it. Justin Bieber went a bit mad on his tour of London last year, started turning up in a gas mask and just doing erratic things. And then there was a story later on of him drag racing on Miami Beach and just doing really unpredictable things. And people just don't make the connections. They see all these artists and they say, why are they so crazy? Why do they do these things? Why is Lindsay Lohan running wild all the time? You know, these people have all this money and all this fame and fortune, and yet they seem so unhappy, and why do they feel the need to behave this way? Well, when you start to understand how mind control is used on many of these prominent artists, it answers a lot of questions about why they do behave the way they do. Next example, Miley Cyrus, another one to have come out of the Disney camp, Hannah Montana. They love this good girl gone bad type thing. They use it time and time again. That was actually the title of a Rihanna album, Good Girl Gone Bad. They present to you somebody like Britney Spears or Miley Cyrus, and they're all kind of cute and cuddly and girl next door and sweet and innocent and squeaky clean. And then there comes a point where they completely switch and they just can't become completely slutty and completely sexually explicit and all the rest of it. And just before we leave the Mickey Mouse ears, interesting to see that Peaches Geldof was pictured wearing Mickey Mouse ears, as was one of her babies in this picture. And an interesting little record sleeve, just as an aside, which came out by Eddie and the Hot Rods. It's got Aleister Crowley wearing a pair of Mickey Mouse ears. What could be going on there? So there is more to say about mind control, and I think maybe on another occasion I'll be able to do that. But we get into even more sinister territory now. It does get darker, sadly. And we have the sort of evoking and summoning up of demonic entities that we see being done by music artists by way of songs and videos. And there was this entity that we encountered earlier, which many researchers, as I said, have taken to be a depiction of Baphomet. But there's a guy called Lennon Onner, this US researcher and author, who has suggested that this is actually a depiction of this strange entity that's been referenced in quite a lot of songs lately, known as Rain Man. And he suggests that the movie Rain Man with Dustin Hoffman and Tom Cruise was created as a kind of smokescreen and a kind of cover story for what this Rain Man thing was all about. It was like the plausible deniability aspect of it, so that everyone would think it was a reference to this movie. But we've had these interesting quotes from artists in recent years. Eminem has said, "My name isn't going to be Slim Shady no more, no more Eminem either. If I do come back, you know what my new name's going to be? Rain Man." What's going on? Then Jay-Z, separate occasion, separate interview.
He says, I look at music like a puzzle, figure out the emotion on the track, what it's saying, then I go through my Rain Man. I can't explain it to y'all, it just comes out of the air for me. You start mumbling. And then you have other artists that have these alter egos, and they seem to morph into these other identities. One of Beyoncé's is known as Sasha Fierce. She put out an album called I Am Sasha Fierce, and she's given interviews along these lines. Known for being sexy, seductive, and provocative when performing on stage, she says that's her alter ego, Sasha Fierce. And she says she's too aggressive, too strong, too sassy, and too sexy, saying, I'm not like her in real life at all. She created Sasha so she can keep her stage persona separate from who she really is. So they're putting this out there in the public domain in interviews and such, and they're basically admitting that they have these kind of alternative identities that they slip into. So it's partly evidence of trauma-based mind control going on, but there also seems to be an element of channeling entities from, you know, the beyond. So that's where we get into some deep and dark territory. And there was this picture of Beyoncé on in a public performance where on the right-hand side there, it appears like she's starting to morph into something else. And interestingly, her management tried to get that picture removed from the internet at the time, saying it was deeply unflattering. But there could have been another reason why they didn't want people to see what was going on, because there seems to be an element of shape-shifting going on there. One other thing for which the music industry is being used, as is the entertainment industry in general, Hollywood films, TV, even advertising, and fashion, and sport, and everything you can imagine, is pushing this Illuminati elite controllers' dream of transhumanism, a transhumanist society, which is what they are desperately trying to bring in. The merging of humanity with machines, with technology. Part of it is the microchipping agenda. We know that they are trying to get microchips inserted into humans. They are trying to get babies chipped at birth, and they're trying to get brain implants into people as well. And they try and sell it as a really palatable, fashionable, marketable sort of thing. You know, imagine what you could do if your performance and your intelligence could be enhanced with the use of technology. Wouldn't it be great, folks? That's the way they try and sell it to you. And to try and settle this idea into the minds of the general public, they do, you know, their predictive programming type stuff with music artists as well. So you get sleeves like this, the Justin Timberlake one, where he's kind of merging with this machine. And then you get artists like will.i.am and so many others, T-Pain, Akon, have made this production method their trademark, their hallmark. You're probably familiar with it. You listen to most pop songs now, and most of what alleges to be hip-hop and R&B and even reggae music now, and you hear this bloody awful, ridiculous production method known as auto-tune. And this is where they plug the artist's voice into this computer software. And the cover story behind this is that it helps singers hit certain notes that they're trying to reach, and it kind of improves the performance. But unfortunately, the downside of it is that it makes them sound like a friggin' robot. And they end up sounding like Stephen Hawking's voice box with the batteries on the blink, you know. Totally artificial, totally electronic, and very much in line with this transhumanist agenda that they're trying to push. Imagine what humanity could be if it was merged and mutated with technology. And we've reached the point now where the vast majority, I would say, of songs in certain genres feature vocalists using this auto-tune program. And it's become so fashionable with young people that want to be pop stars to sound this way, that there have even been instances of people auditioning for these bloody awful shows like The X Factor, and they've been structuring their vocal style to mimic the sound of auto-tune, because they think that's how you've got to sound now to have a hit and to make it big. That's how much it's got out there. And people say, it's just a fad, it's just a trend, it's just a fashionable thing. Well, this has been going on since about 2007 now, by my estimation. So that's 7 years, going on eight, which is quite a long time for a fad and a trend, given that, you know, punk only lasted, what, a year or a year and a half in its core form. And all these other forms of music, new wave and garage and drum and bass, had all had their heyday within a much shorter time period than that. And yet they tell us it's just a fad and a trend. I would suggest there's something else going on. When it comes to auto-tune, it doesn't get more blatant than this total joker that goes by the name of Future. So there's something innocent, something interesting in the name. Are they suggesting that this is how they want the future to sound? His entire trademark on all his cameo appearances on records is completely computerized and completely electronic and anything but human sounding. And no presentation on the manipulations of the music industry would be complete without a little bit of ritual sacrifice, would it? So, should we go there? Yeah, why not? One thing that I do remember finding strange in the years when I was still a slumbering drone and I was completely asleep and I swallowed every story that the BBC News gave me because I didn't know any better. But one thing that I do remember finding a bit strange was the fact that a few months before the hip-hop artist Tupac was murdered, the anniversary was a few days ago, that was 18 years ago, 1996. A few days before that happened, a few weeks before that happened, this album came out, and it was credited to Machiavelli, which was his artist alter ego, and it was called the Don Caluminati. And on the sleeve, it depicts Tupac being crucified, and a few weeks later he was dead. Then we have the other high-profile rapper that was murdered in virtually identical circumstances 6 months later, in March 97, Notorious B.I.G. And a few weeks before that happened, we had this album called Life After Death, in which he's in a funeral suit standing next to a hearse. And his first album was called Ready to Die, and the posthumous album that came out after this was called Born Again. So in every one of his albums, there's kind of morbid, mortal sort of overtones to the titles. Here's a guy that could probably answer a few questions about it. Puff Daddy, P. Diddy, whatever the hell he's calling himself this week. There was a hoax story that broke this week. I was kind of hoping it was real, but it turned out to be a hoax, suggesting that Puffy had been arrested by detectives in Las Vegas in connection with Tupac's murder. But there is a lot to know about this character, and I would suggest that he's the epitome of someone that's sold their soul for fame and fortune in a very major way. Don't have time to go into it tonight, but there is a great book by a former artist on his record label, a guy by the name of Mark Curry, used to be on Bad Boy Records, and he exposes the true nature of this guy, Puff Daddy, and the way he treated his artists and just the type of character that he was in this book, Dancing with the Devil. So this is Whitney Houston with her longtime mentor, Clive Davis, of the Arista Corporation, and he's worked with many of the big record corporations in the US since the 1960s. And he was the guy that was credited with bringing Whitney Houston into the public domain and launching her career. And of course, she was discovered, you might recall, in some very suspicious circumstances, dead in a bathtub in a hotel room in Los Angeles in, I think it was 2012. And there was this very strange business of a party for the Grammy Awards, which was going on in that hotel, just a few floors underneath her body lying dead in the bathtub, which went ahead despite the fact that news of her death had already broken. And the party was instigated by this guy, Clive Davis. And, you know, many researchers have looked into what's going on here. And there is the suggestion that this party was being held as a celebration of the fact that this artist that the industry had spawned and brought through all the way had been ritually sacrificed as part of one of their sick, twisted rituals. who knows why they do these things, but they do seem the feel the need every now and again to sacrifice one of their artists. So, as I said, there's some very strange elements behind the deaths of Tupac, Notorious B.I.G., Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston, strange stuff involving John Lennon, Bob Marley, and Amy Winehouse, and any number of other artists as well. And there's a very strong suggestion there that when it suits those dark occultists that are pulling the strings of the music industry to do so, they take one of their artists out to fulfill some kind of sick agenda in line with their beliefs. A guy that goes into this whole idea of ritual sacrifices within the industry is Professor Griff, who used to be with the group Public Enemy, Ministry of Information for Public Enemy. And he put out this book, Death of Hip Hop Illuminati. He's done many other books as well. And he goes in big time on some of the rituals that take place. Michael Jackson hologram, that's what we're seeing now. I can't help thinking that if the industry didn't take out its own artists, it wouldn't have to make holograms of them to perform at stage shows, you know. Keep the original artist alive, and you don't have to do this. But then you can look at these holograms that we're seeing on stage now. There was one of Tupac as well, and you've got to wonder whether this is part of the transhumanist agenda, the glorification of technology, the merging of technology with humanity, and it's all part of what they're trying to achieve. Katy Perry, another great example of an absolute manipulated stooge, probably mind-controlled, one-time wife of Russell Brand, make of that what you will. And she came out with this quote in an interview recently, I want to join the Illuminati. And what we've seen in recent times is a trivialization of this idea that there is an occult secret society known as the Illuminati, or that there are secret societies at all that pull the strings of human affairs. And there seems to be an attempt to make light of it and just make it fashionable to talk about the Illuminati in the same way that people used to talk about Tony Montana, Scarface, or Don Corleone, the Godfather. We're hearing lyrics like this coming into hip-hop now, you know, Rick Ross and Jay-Z and people like that will be name-checking the Illuminati in a way that they used to name-check Scarface and all these other gangster movies and stuff. A Facebook group that came out the other year, Kenya Devil Worshippers and the Illuminati. I love this story. There was a nightclub in Atlanta known as Illuminate. And somebody, this is a genuine Facebook screen cap, somebody on their Facebook page had written, the Illuminati, you're the reason this world is so fucked up. And the answer from the nightclub was, we're not the Illuminati, we are Illuminate Fridays, a branded night that showcases top DJs and quality production here in Atlanta. And then the original poster says, oh, okay, sorry. It's a classic. But you now have kids coming home from school. There's been examples of this. And where they have free-flow art lessons, and they can draw whatever they want, they're drawing pyramids with capstones and eyes in them. And they're coming home and saying, and they're writing Illuminati on it. You know, there's so much... There's so much talk of the Illuminati in popular culture now, and it's become such a buzzword that kids are picking up on it and they're drawing pictures about it. And I think it's all part of an attempt to pass it off as something that's quite innocent and it's a bit cool and it's a bit fashionable and it's a bit naughty to talk about it, but it doesn't really have any bearing on what's truly going on. This is the 27 Club. Sorry, the picture's a bit small, but is some of the many artists over the years that just happen to have died at the age of 27. From Jimi Hendrix to Janis Joplin to Jim Morrison to Kurt Cobain, Amy Winehouse, Robert Johnson. And the idea there is that there's something about the age 27 that causes those that are controlling these artists to want to take them out in some kind of ritual. So this is a section where I go in on Kanye West, and I don't have time to do it full justice tonight, but Kanye West is a great example of a thoroughly decent artist when he first emerged, making quite conscious, quite meaningful, quite positive music, who has quite clearly been stepped up a few notches through the ranks and has been required to start doing some work for his masters and is now making some very different kind of music to what he did before. And I've put a couple of lyrics up here in a compare and contrast style. The top one was one of his songs from his College Dropout album, his debut album of 2003. Quite a profound statement for a mainstream hip-hop track. We live in the American dream. People highest up got the lowest self-esteem. The prettiest people do the ugliest things for the road to riches and diamond rings. Later on, 2012, that's the sort of stuff he's talking about now. I would say something happened. I was very disappointed to see the same thing happen with Lupe Fiasco, who's another rapper that started putting out some very meaningful tracks. This top track, Words I Never Said, 2010, this got played on the radio. And he's saying, Gaza Strip was getting bombed. Obama didn't say shit. That's in a record that people are hearing in the general public. That is an amazing statement to have slipped through the net. But then you see, in 2014, in the song Thorns and Horns, this is the sort of stuff he's talking about now. I would say he's been pulled into line. Another artist, Gone Bad, started out with quite a different character and persona to the one we see now, is the singer Robin Thicke. There he is with Jay-Z, and here he is with Miley Cyrus. On stage at some awards show recently. And Robin's recently got divorced from his wife amidst claims of his infidelity. So I don't know if that's got anything to do with it. But he'll be all right. He's got enough money now. And I really found myself agreeing big time with this author, John Hamer, with this statement, which I came across recently, where he says, many of the household name musicians early in their careers are lured into a subtle trap, baited with money and fame, and then their handlers sink their claws and teeth into them. They realize they're caught with no possible escape route, and they're condemned to continue with their charade for the rest of their careers, which often ends prematurely for one reason or another. Couldn't agree more with that one. Now, this is a still from a stage show by a very prominent artist from over the years. Does anyone know whose stage show this might be? It's from a couple of weeks ago, 2 or 3 weeks ago, and it's the comeback concert at Hammersmith of Kate Bush. And Kate Bush has always been taken to be this wonderful artist who makes completely individual, esoteric, beautiful music. I've always been a big fan of her stuff myself. She makes songs about the transcendental number of pi and sound technology and sound weapons and William Reich and Orgone technology. Amazing stuff. But then you discover that in 2012, quite recently, she accepted a CBE from the Queen, which in my view is an indicator of the fact that you now belong to the system. You know, I'm sure many of us have done some research into the true nature of the Queen and the royal family and what they're all about. And I would suggest that for someone that's awake and conscious and knows the score, accepting any kind of CBE or OBE is not the thing to do. And so now we have this comeback concert with all kinds of disturbing occultic imagery in it, just like so many of the other artists that have gone before. Bono, I mean, you know, speaks for itself, really. I do a joke at this point, yeah? Sorry. I should have apologised for the bad language before, but, you know, I always like to do that. Anyway, I'm starting to wrap up now. Some more examples of lyrics here. There's Little Wayne on a good day. Here's the sort of stuff that's going into, you know, records that kids are listening to, young people. I've got two small girls myself, and, you know, I'm going to make it my life's work to keep them away from records called Arse. That's actually the title of the record, and you can see the lyrics for yourself. It goes Arse, 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 and so on. And then we have Go Stupid, Go Stupid, Go Stupid, and Wobbledy Wobbly, and all this sort of stuff. Lovely, touching lyric from Nicki Minaj. Genuine lyrics. These are real. I'm not making these up. You know, you can get these songs. Sorry, there's another one. Genuine lyric. You know, they said it, not me. There's another one. This came out from Chuck D, formerly of Public Enemy. He dropped a new album recently, and one of his lyrics in it was, 11-year-olds can't relate to champagne, silent N-words, and marketing campaigns. Couldn't agree more. Thank God there's some real artists that are saying what needs to be said out there still. And I have to end on this, really. There's this famous meeting, which, again, a lot of people may have heard about, which took place in March 1969, and it was out of Planned Parenthood, part of the Rockefeller Foundation, and there was this paediatrician called Dr. Richard Day, and he was addressing a bunch of other paediatricians, and it was supposed to be a secret, behind-closed-doors meeting, and what he did was to outline all the changes to human society that were planned to take place in the decades to come, and he went through, you know, changes to healthcare, changes to the political arena, changes to political correctness and such, social engineering, and he got on to music and entertainment. And this is what he said. Pornography, violence, and obscenity on TV and in movies will be increased. People will be desensitized to violence and porn and made to feel life is short, precarious, and brutish. Music will get worse and will be used for indoctrination. And he would appear to have been right on the money with that one. So, just starting to wrap up. What a lot of people say to you when you start to expose some of this dark stuff that's going on, whether it's trauma-based mind control, ritual sacrifice, all this other occult stuff that's going on, people of a kind of new age persuasion, people into that particular brand of spirituality, often say to you, this is negative. And by talking about it and by focusing attention on it, you're only empowering it. You're helping it to continue. This statement kind of sums up how I feel about it. I don't see it that way. I think that to find any kind of solution for the problems that we find ourselves facing, you've got to understand the nature of the problem. And you need to research it to know what you're up against. You need to know the nature of the problem to be able to formulate any kind of solution. And information isn't negative or positive, it's neutral. And the truth is the truth. And it always will be. It doesn't matter whether anyone believes it. It doesn't matter what anyone might think of it. It doesn't care for that. It goes on being the truth. And the truth is unwavering and eternal. And it's always there. And we just need to understand it. And so, you know, the question arises, when we do understand how we're being manipulated and mind-controlled and engineered, how can we break free of the programming? How can we overcome it? And to a certain extent, it's the same as with anything else. When you discover the truth about, let's say, vaccines, for example, and what goes into vaccines and their true nature, you can make the conscious free will choice not to take vaccines and not to give them to your kids, as an example. When you discover the truth about GM foods and what they can do to the human body, you have the opportunity to make the free will conscious choice yourself not to engage with them, not to take them. Same with fluoride in water and toothpaste. Don't drink the water and find a fluoride-free toothpaste. You know, these are options that are open to you. And when you come to understand and accept how music and entertainment generally is being used, first of all, you can detach from these artists if you choose to and not listen to this music. But it's all about just raising your consciousness and breaking free of the sort of low density frequency range that they're trying to keep you in with all this negative stuff. Once you gain that understanding, you raise your consciousness and you kind of rise above all that, and the old tricks don't work on you anymore. The brainwashing and the subliminal programming that used to take place, now you know what you're looking for. Now you can spot the signs a mile off. They're not having that same effect as they did. And it's a raising of consciousness throughout humanity that is needed to break free of all the problems that we're facing. And so it's a case of
waking people up to what's being done to them, and then giving them the opportunity to make that free will conscious choice to change things for the better collectively. And everyone has an individual contribution that they can make to that process. As part of the awakening that we have the opportunity to do if we choose to. That's how I feel about it. Another thing to mention is that there is still positive, conscious, meaningful music being made, and there's some great artists out there that are articulating so much of what's on people's minds these days. And I do this fortnightly podcast radio show on my SoundCloud page called The Sound of Freedom, which brings together music from just such artists. And it goes way back in the day as well. I do this thing called The Truth Trip, which is where I go back to the 60s, 70s, 80s, decades past, and play songs that were talking back then about topics that are so relevant today. So I bring all that together in a podcast every couple of weeks, and you can get it from my website, which is markdevlin.co.uk. And, you know, I think putting positive, conscious sounds out there is also a part of the process of overcoming what's been done to us. So understanding of all this is a very positive step, I would suggest, and I actually remain quite optimistic about how everything is going to turn out in the end. And that's pretty much all I've got to say. So thanks to everyone for coming out tonight, and I appreciate your support. Evening, folks. Thanks for turning out tonight. Sorry for the technical difficulties once again. Despite being a DJ, I'm actually a technical Luddite, totally clueless, always reliant on there being some techno boffins around to help me out. So, you know, that's important. I've done probably about 10 of these talks now with this content, and each time it grows in length because I find myself needing to add lyrical content to it, or needing to add something topical that's just happened in the music industry to help illustrate the points. So it's up to about 3 hours now, and I know we don't have 3 hours tonight, so I'm going to present an abridged version, and I'm going to be zipping through various aspects of it quite quickly, but we'll see where it takes us anyway. Little bit of introduction then, just to set the scene. I've been a DJ for the last 20 odd years, 24 years. Radio and club DJ, and I've been fortunate enough to travel all over the UK in that time and to many different countries around the world. And for many years, I didn't really give much thought to what it was I was a part of. I just played the role that was expected of a DJ in terms of taking music that you're serviced by the record companies and the promo companies and playing it in appropriate settings. And as I say, I was quite oblivious to anything else that might be going on behind the scenes for many years. But it got to 2008, and at that point in my life, I started having quite a lot of questions about what was really going on in the world and what this world and this reality is anyway. And the process started in 2008 with me reading a lot of books by various different authors and researchers. Much of it I was put onto by my dad, who's always been a free-thinking, alternative-minded sort of guy. And the process accelerated by 2010.
Control and manipulate pretty much every area of human activity. So they've had politics locked down since the year dot. They've come to infiltrate and control the educational establishments, schools, colleges, universities, and such. They've come to infiltrate the scientific establishment in terms of establishing scientific norms and in terms of building a perception of what is possible and what isn't possible in the physical world, or apparently physical world. They've come to infiltrate and control all the big corporations, all the telecoms and communications industries, the food and drink industries, and the military, of course. And once you've taken the time and trouble to manipulate and control all those different areas of human life, it would be very remiss of you to leave out a brilliant opportunity for mind control and social engineering and shaping people's perceptions of themselves and the world that they live in, that is presented by the entertainment industry. And the three main strands of that would. And for a split second, again, blink and you miss it, you get this horrific kind of demonic face just flashing up on the screen. It's a bit dark there, but I'm sure you can get the idea of what's going on. Another pyramid image from Rihanna, they're all over the place. You see the same sort of images cropping up time and time again with the same artists as well. This one is Kanye West's video for Power, and you've got everything going on here. And the interesting thing about this video is it's just one image for the course of the 3-minute song. And the camera starts panned in on some very close detail, and during the course of the song it pans out and you get to see more and more of the detail. Those that study symbolism and the occult would have a field day with this, but there's all kinds of stuff going on. I would question what it's doing in an apparent pop music video. So now we get into some of the interesting hand symbols that many of the A-list artists are flashing up in their videos all the time now. This was something that I started to look at the same time as all these symbols in videos. This is a very common one, which Jay-Z has done many times over the years. And he makes this sort of triangular sign with his hands. And the cover story for it is that it's the rock sign. It's referred to as the rock sign. It's supposed to be a celebration of bling hip-hop culture, rags to riches, you know, making it big through the music game. And he will throw up the instruction in live concerts to all the fans to throw up your rock signs. And it's supposed to symbolize a diamond, as in a rock. And I was interested quite a while later to discover that this particular sign is one of the grade signs that was used by the AA occult organization. Nothing to do with alcohol or automobiles, but one of the secret societies that Aleister Crowley was ahead of at one time. And here we have Jay-Z flashing up this same symbol. And here's the guy that he chose to name his record company after. Rockefeller, David Rockefeller there, patriarch of the Rockefeller bloodline currently. Jay-Z, when he first formed his record label, decided to call it Rockefeller, as in Rock a Fella. These days it's known as Rock Nation. But of all the people that you could use as an inspiration for your business venture,
I would question your judgment if you choose this guy, given what his family represents. And so here we have a bunch of Jay-Z fans on instruction throwing up their rock signs in a concert. And I came to understand, as part of this conscious awakening, that everything in existence is made up of sound and light energy, vibrating and resonating at different frequencies. And it's all about manipulating energy. If you understand the way reality works, and if you want to harness it and control it in line with your agenda. And clearly, those that pull the strings of the music industry understand this, and they have a vested interest in certain symbols being put out there into the sort of morphogenic field, because they have an effect on the reality that manifests as a result of that. And so it's all about the will and the intent that is placed on the symbol when it's created. So you have these fans thinking that the symbol they're throwing up is representing one thing, the celebration of, you know, bling hip-hop culture, but in actual fact, those that have manipulated them into creating this symbol have other intentions as to the effect that it's intended to have. And as I said, it doesn't always have humanity's best interests at heart. Here we have a familiar symbol, the pyramid with the all-seeing eye and the detached capstone that you see on the back of the US dollar bill. And we see that cropping up many times in videos and other symbols as well, which we'll get onto. Jay-Z and his best mate Kanye West doing the same symbol. Another one there. And here's Mrs. Jay-Z, Beyonce, although probably not for much longer, if the celebrity rags are to be believed. And this was at a Grammys event in 2013, where Beyonce was performing at the halftime show. And so you have to ask yourself, what's really happening? And what are they really trying to communicate here? Could it be that ultimately, all these individuals, from Obama to Justin Bieber and everyone in between, is owned and controlled by the same individuals that operate from behind the shadows. So there's Bill Clinton doing it. Sorry for the grainy photograph, but there's George Bush Sr. doing it as well. Where do you start with that guy? I haven't got time to go into him tonight. Benjamin Netanyahu, just a coincidence, nothing to worry about. The Pope, impersonating an owl. But why would he? The mass murdering paedophile Satanist war criminal Tony Blair. And here's... I was holding back a bit there. That was the edited version. And here's a few more faces that we recognise of late as well. Can you tell what's going on yet? Can you tell what it is? Yeah, every time I put him on, it brings a gasp. I love the reaction to that one. So, yeah, here we have some old family favourites all doing the same symbol. And before we leave it, here's one more. No further comment on that one. We're not allowed to yet, are we? The time will come. And so we go to the Beatles. And there's a fair bit to say about the Beatles as well. As I say, this thing goes way back to decades past. In this very interesting promo pic for Yellow Submarine, we got Paul McCartney doing the same sort of owl thing that the Pope was. And we got John Lennon doing the old horned hand Baphomet sign. And this is interesting as well. Tony Prince, the founder of the DMC Disco Mix Club and a prominent DJ on Radio Luxembourg for many years, at the funeral of his mate Jimmy Savile, felt the need to flash up that sign to the camera as well. And one more thing that we see time and time again with popular artists is a depiction of the devil horns. There's a particularly sinister one from M&M, which is quite unsettling. I'm sure you'd agree. And once again, it's a symbol that we can see depicted by Anton LaVey, our old mate from the Church of Satan. There he is doing the horned hand sign there, which many researchers have suggested is another evocation of the Baphomet entity and a sort of calling card of Satanism. And there it is again. And here's a few more doing it. Hillary Clinton, no great surprise with her. And Barry again. And there's Baphomet, him or herself, itself, just reminding you what it looks like and what they're all evoking with what they're doing. Something else which has been creeping into videos and promo shots quite a bit in recent years, and which I didn't understand at first, was the highlighting or the depiction of one eye. And there are various ways of doing this. There was this style of photography that became very cool and fashionable a few years ago, where you just get half of an individual's face and the other eye is out of range. And I couldn't understand why it was a good idea to do this, but you start seeing it everywhere. Here's Rihanna and Lady Gaga, and there are various ways of just drawing attention to the one eye. Sometimes it's circling it, sometimes it's covering it, sometimes there's a hat over it or hair over it. And it's all about symbolising the all-seeing eye, the one eye that you see in the capstone of that pyramid on the dollar bill. There are also connotations there with the pineal gland, you know, the so-called third eye, and the portal to higher consciousness. And it's tied into symbolism in Freemasonry as well. And it's another big Illuminati calling card. And here's a composite that somebody put together of just all the artists that you can see doing this thing with their eye. And I know you can't see the detail, but trust me, everyone is in there. And it's pretty much all the A-list artists of the day. And you come to realize that it's no longer possible to be a successful artist in the mainstream music industry without selling your soul, signing up to the program, and stepping the television industry, Hollywood movies, and the music industry. And the music industry is what sparked my interest in terms of the way it's used for these purposes, having been a lifelong music fan and having worked in it for so long. I bought my first record when I was 5, so I've always been into the pop music of the day. That was Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody, by the way, if anyone's wondering, which isn't too uncool. But I reached the point where I came to realise that what I was a part of as a radio and club DJ was being used for, questionable ends by those that don't have humanity's best interests at heart, shall we say. So there's many aspects to how the music industry is being used along these lines, and we're going to look at a fair few of those this evening. Always good to start with a quote from Plato, I feel. Which just sums up the way that music is so powerful in making you feel a certain way. It can really play with the emotions and really create sensations. And of course, the manipulators know this. So one of the first things that really sparked my attention was some of the symbolism and imagery that was starting to get put into music videos. I remember days when music videos bore some kind of relation to the song and the artist in question. Often they were very overblown and pretentious, but you didn't get a lot of dark occult symbolism in them, which we've seen over the past few years. And I noticed this happening from around about 2007, 2008, big time, when it really seemed like the agenda was getting stepped up. Here's a good example from the song Die Young, lovely song by Kesha. Sentiments are all about, hey, let's all go out and get wasted and party and have sex with whoever we want because we're all going to die young anyway and life is just pointless and aimless, so who cares? Really nice sentiments for a teenage audience there. And in the video, there are three stills here. And we have an upside down cross. We have a pentagram, which you might expect to be inverted, but in this instance, it's not. And we have a pyramid with an all-seeing eye in it. And this is very representative of many symbols that I'm seeing cropping up time and time again in popular music videos. We have one here from the song Scream and Shout, Will.i.am and Britney Spears. And here's just one of so many examples you see now of a pyramid. We've also got some monarch butterflies going on in this as well. And if I get time to go into the section on mind control, MK Ultra mind control and monarch programming, you'll see how that fits in. Here's a lovely one as well for your kids to see. This is a video by Rihanna from the single Umbrella, which came out in 2007, big number one hit. And you have this scene where, on the left there, she's apparently striking a particular pose within a pyramid. But when you look at the image closer, you see that that pose is physically, anatomically impossible to achieve. And the image has been digitally manipulated, and there are many researchers that have said that what we're seeing is a depiction of Baphomet, the satanic entity as it's been adopted as. And we've got the horns going on there, and we've got the sort of face of Baphomet being evoked by this image. Either way, pretty dark stuff to find in a pop video, I'm sure you'd agree. And the other thing about this particular image is that it's on screen for a split second. You blink and you miss it, and it's gone. And this is designed, of course, to go straight into the subliminal mind, which absorbs so many things that the conscious mind doesn't. And that's where the real power and the effect lies. This is another split second image that you see in a song, it's claimed to be, by Lil Wayne, Love Me. I don't know what I'd call it, but it wouldn't be a song. And there's a line in it where he says, "These hoes love me like Satan, man." I'm not entirely sure why the hoes would love Satan in the first place, but apparently they do. And at the point where he says that, he kind of turns into this demonic entity, and you've got the girl there with a monarch butterfly covering one of her eyes. Again, that's a split second one. As is this, and there's no apparent reason for this to be in the video that it is. It's in a video by Robin Thicke, Give It To You. Spontaneously threw up this same hand signal just for a split second as the cameras were on her. And there was some speculation at the time as to what the meaning was behind this. The cover story, because there's always a cover story, was that she was paying homage to her old man's record label and kind of supporting him, but there could be something else going on here, I would suggest. And all this stuff with hand signals has become so embedded in popular culture now that the Sun, that bastion of truth and integrity, actually ran an article on it last year, and they titled it "Jay-Z, Rihanna, and the Cabal Obsessed with Triangles That Now Runs the World," with "allegedly" in brackets. And the tone of the piece is very mocking. You know, they're kind of taking the piss out of conspiracy theorists, so-called, and kind of writing it all off as just this innocent thing. And they would suggest that the reason the artists choose to put up these hand signals and all the rest of it is just to be cool and to be fashionable. But you'd expect the Sun to kind of write off the story in that way, because that's its agenda. But I do find it interesting that the whole thing has embedded itself in popular culture to the extent that the Sun is actually running stories on it. And here we have Anton LaVey, founder of the Church of Satan in the US, throwing up the same symbol that we've seen before a few times. So that particular hand signal certainly gets around a bit. And we're back to the pyramid, another one that crops up time and time again. And this featured on the back of a jacket worn by Madonna in the movie Desperately Seeking Susan, going back to 1985 for this, long before any talk of the Illuminati or New World Order or any such concepts were being discussed, you know, on a cultural level. And who noticed this at the time or understood the significance of it? But when you see artists brazenly flaunting symbols like this, which are basically the calling cards of the organisations that own them, they're just sending out a little message there as to who their true masters are. And we'll also get into the extent to which many of these artists are truly owned and have truly sold their souls to the corporations that control them as we go on, and not speaking figuratively either, speaking literally. So here's another hand signal that we'll see a lot of, and it's Beyoncé once again. And this was, I think, the Super Bowl halftime show of last year, straight after the Grammys. And she was in the audience this time, and as the camera came round, she flashed up this symbol with her fingers. And as I said, everything comes with a cover story in this world, an innocent, plausible deniability sort of reason for it being. And this symbol is often taken popularly to mean okay. When you do this, you're just saying everything's okay, everything's cool. But I would suggest that it has other connotations. Many researchers into the dark occult will tell you that it's a depiction of a six, and the three fingers are supposed to indicate the fact that you've taken the six three times, so effectively it's 666. And if that is a symbol that you want getting put out there into the energetic field and having the effect that you desire, what better way than to create a cover story for it and to get everyone thinking that what they're actually saying is, it's okay, everything's okay. But in actual fact, it's having another effect without these people realizing it. And here we have Justin Bieber, and we'll hear from him later as well, doing the same sort of thing over the eye as well. So it's two symbols for the price of one there. And a very young Michael Jackson. One thing that I did come to discover was that the manipulation and control of prominent music artists goes way back, pretty much to the creation of the pop music industry. I was a bit green and a bit naive in the early days in terms of thinking it to be a modern phenomenon, something that's, you know, really happened with artists in the last few years. But it becomes clear as you look into it that it's been going on forever. So here's a young Michael Jackson, probably having no clue what's going on, just being asked to do this signal in a photo shoot. And not just pop stars either. You see some of these symbols going on in other walks of life as well.